Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the Shadow and Sun Show, and welcome back to another top secret module review. This time, I've got potentially my favorite so far. That's right, the Agent 13 Sourcebook. Put out in 1988 by Ray Winiger. This one is right up my alley. 1930s pulp greatness in all its glory. For those of you who don't know, Agent 13 was an orphan child brought into the Brotherhood that once upon a time, thousands of years ago, was an organization, a worldwide global secret society bent on fixing the world and making it a better place. But some 2,000 years ago, a member of the Brotherhood subverted it, took it over, and turned it into a force of evil. And unwittingly, Agent 13 was brought up in it until he found out its dark and sinister secret and decided to go against it and basically take it apart brick by brick. And in this source book, you get to play one of many types of heroes in the 1930s. The overall system works with the original top secret SI, but in here it throws a little bit of a twist. There being three different modes of play: the dark and gritty, the moderate, and the far-fetched. And each one has its own parameters on how many advantages and powers that your characters can have, depending on the level, each one getting progressively more far-fetched, let's say. And it includes a whole bunch of new advantages, as well as some superpowers ranging from invisibility to teleportation and mind control. And of course, if the players are going to have abilities far beyond those of normal mortals, as will the bad guys, the supervillains, if you will. It's not quite a Marvel or DC level of superheroism, but more of the 1930s radio show The Shadow and Doc Savage and characters like that. Although the bad guys are going to be pretty flamboyant and pretty powerful, that's why you need a group of heroes to come together and thwart their evil plans. Now, this book has got everything you need to play, including some things that I wasn't really expecting. Besides the setting rules, there's a whole lot of work on the exotic devices and gadgets and building them, and some parameters on, you know, things you should and shouldn't allow. But then again, you know, this being, you know, a fantasy contemporary world, you know, it's up to the GM to decide exactly where he cuts off the craziness. There's also a really nice section on the archetypes of the types of heroes that were common back in the day. The gangbusters, you know, your Elliot Nesses, the men of mystery, the jungle adventurers, the Tarzans, the Solomon Kanes, that sort of thing. The lost civilization adventures, you know, going into, you know, places like Antarctica or the deepest, darkest Africa, or even the center of the Earth. A little bit on some sci-fi things, because Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon were also characters very similar in this vein. And then, of course, a nice good section on the villains. But what I wasn't expecting was things like adding horror to the top secret genre, if you will. But then there was also a wonderful section on secret headquarters, NPCs, and the world of the 30s. Now, it goes quite deep in helping the GM not have to do the research himself, because you could just go down a number of rabbit holes. But it gives you history of the United States, Germany, the Soviet Union, Japan, Because you're going to more than likely pull your villains from places like that to throw against the PCs. Then there's a 1930s timeline of important events from 1931 all the way to 1939. And it basically gives you a whole bunch of events that were, you know, pretty big for that year, letting you know, for example, 1937, the Loyalists, anti-Franco factions suffer a major defeat in Spain. Japan attacks China and quickly captures Shanghai. Stalin purges the Red Army. The Hindenburg explodes over New Jersey shortly after completing its first transatlantic flight. 36 lives are lost. Things like that all the way to the end of the 30s. But it also tells you things about daily life in the 30s. Excuse me, I need some water. Entertainments and the arts. The law. How the law was vastly different than you know, the law we're supposed to have right now. It goes into how sports were back then. What housing was like. Clothing costs. Tools of the trade, basic services, you know, how much it would cost for things, because so many game books just kind of make that stuff up without really giving you accurate prices. The original Top Secret was famous for that. The prices in there were, you know, just completely off kilter from the way it really was. And, you know, I was around back then and I was buying many of those things. And then it follows up with, at the very end, The Curse of Fu Shang, who is a Mandarin supervillain with, you know, several superpowers and an overall, you know, nice little 10-page adventure to get you into the mood of the 1930s and Agent 13. This was just so much fun. This sort of adventure really, really hits me. I'm a huge fan of pulp, as you guys know. And things like, obviously, The Shadow and Doc Savage and the radio shows of back then. And, you know, as well as, you know, James Bond and the other secret agent heroes that we're all familiar with. But this one gives you a chance to make your own in a brand new version of Earth with, you know, little twists along the way that you don't normally see, especially in a straight, you know, hard science espionage adventure game. I'm going to hit up a couple more other espionage games along the way, but this is the last one in this series, that being I don't know if it's the last one. I think there's one more. Well, there's a couple of books I'm missing, so I'm going to do a follow-up with all the PDFs that I'm missing, because like G3 Guns, Gadgets, and Getaway Vehicles, I don't have that book, so I'm going to do it on a PDF, but I figure I might as well just do a PDF review of the three volumes I don't have, and if I'm gonna, you know, need to add them to my collection anytime soon. Now, later on in this line, there is another superheroic version of the game called Freelancers and Free America, which is far more a post-apocalyptic version of a superhero game. And I'm not sure how I feel about that. It sounds interesting, but it also sounds maybe harder to pull off. Doing things in the past seem for most people a lot easier. I'm also going to do a video on Gatekeepers next week, probably about contemporary real earth role playing game situations and why I think it's such a hard genre to get people to play in. Most people don't want to play in the real world, so to speak. They're more comfortable with fantasy and sci-fi worlds, which is, for me, just seems a little weird. But this one was so much fun. I also have the Agent 13 paperback novels and the graphic novel, which I might do before I get to the next one, because I've actually already read them. So that'll actually probably be the next one. I forget what the next book is in the TAC series, which the next one will be TAC 3. I think it's an operations handbook, which is a little dry and not as exciting as this. And trust me, this has got all of the two-fisted excitement you could ask for and more. So I hope you guys let me know what you thought of the 1930s in the way of role-playing. And if you've ever played this, or if you've ever wanted to If you ever think you will, I'd love to hear about it in the comment section, as always, because lately we've been having some great conversations there, and I really appreciate everybody's been, you know, dropping a line there and letting me know what they think. I get it. I know Top Secret and espionage games are not everybody's bag, and to be honest, they're not most people's bag, but I think if you gave it a try with a group, you know, maybe as a one-shot or something like that, you might be surprised how fun it is and how easy it is to get into that kind of a character, having done some of the PI stuff in the past. I always want to, you know, jump back in, and, you know, I'm not as young as I used to be. I'm no spring chicken, so doing that in the real world is a lot harder, but doing it at the table with some good friends and some Doritos, some Mountain Dew, and some dice, I'm always up for that sort of thing. So let me know if you think you could handle it, because, you know, I may be working toward my Nazi dinosaur cults of Antarctica sooner than I thought, especially with the recent interest in Antarctica, and this would be the perfect book to do it in. I was thinking of Amazing Adventures, but I like the way this one feels. It's a lot easier to do. It's a purely skill-based system as opposed to Amazing Adventures, you know, sort of hackneyed character classes that I was just not really grabbed by. Some of them are okay, but there's so many missing, and I think the players would have more fun making up their own character from the ground up with the Top Secret system. So until next time, folks, have a great weekend. I hope you guys get some gaming in. I've got a game tonight and then again Sunday. For my players out there, hopefully we will get together early Sunday afternoon and get, you know, tidy up some character sheets and get some people rolling. And yeah, thanks, guys. This was a lot of fun, and I will talk to you real soon. And as always, happy trails.